Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Gemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Gemma.
Grace and peace to you. Welcome to Ask Pastor Gemma. In the event that you are a first timer, my name is Gemma Duncan. I'm married to Apostle Vivian Duncan, and together we pastor Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our headquarters is located in Diego Martin on the Diego Martin Main Road opposite Sedanix Drive. We have branches in Sangre Grande in Chaguanas. There's a branch in Faisabad. We have a branch in Tobago, one in Antigua. Our office hours are Monday to Thursday from 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. and the business center is opened Monday to Friday from 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. Pay attention to the fact that on public holidays, everything is closed. We have our regularly scheduled services Sunday at 9 a.m., live and online in all of the branches, and on Thursdays and Fridays at 7 p.m. online only. We also have a special teaching session Mondays at 7:30 p.m. online only. Now, there will be a little bit of adjustments to the Monday night and the Thursday night service, but we will let you know exactly what's taking place. We're making a little bit of shift there, but we will inform you, so look out for some change. We will push everything to the Thursday and Friday only, but we will let you know when. Last week, we started a little in-depth discussion on the types of prayer. And we were able only to do two types out of the 12 that I gave you, and I'm going to list them again. Petition, intercession, worship or adoration, praise, thanksgiving, the prayer of confession or contrition, silence, corporate prayer or the prayer of agreement, prayer of faith, prayer of consecration, praying in the Holy Ghost, prophetic prayers and declarations. And last week, we were only able to look at petition and intercession. And as we said, if you were there or you can join me, go back to Facebook and you will see it. If you look, sometimes the easiest thing to do is look for the outfit and you might see the thing, because this is part two of it. And that is when I spoke about it. And we looked at petition as asking, and we said it's okay to ask because the Bible says that we should. Then we looked at intercession, and intercession simply means praying for others. So these two are something that we do all the time. One of the things that we pointed out, though, was that when we prayed or asked God for something, we have to take into consideration His will and His timing. And there are times when God will say yes, there are times when He will say wait, and there are times when He will say no. And we have to be willing to bow to His sovereignty in terms of His response to our praying. When we talked about intercession, we know He's praying for other people, but then the intercessor himself or herself, there are certain qualifications that would make our intercession more effective. And one of the qualifications is our relationship with God, our knowledge of the scripture, not just knowledge, but our obedience to the word of God. All of that will cause our intercession. When we speak, it gives us greater authority because of our relationship with God, because we are obedient to God's word and our desires to please Him. And when we have that level of relationship with God, when we ask or we petition for other people, there's a better chance of us getting the response that we wanted. And this afternoon, we're going to look at worship. So in a general sense, the entire church service, as we call it, can be considered worship. And we call it corporate worship. So we come and we sing and we read the Bible and we hear preaching and we testify and there may be a dance or whatever it is. That holds a service, as we call it service, is considered worship. But this evening, when we talk about types of prayer, we're really looking at individual worship, not just the corporate worship, because there's an extension of corporate worship that I heard a preacher say, and I have now embraced it as my own philosophy. Not only should we do corporate worship, worship in the sanctuary worship, but lifestyle worship. And the worship we're talking about here this evening in terms of as a type of prayer is lifestyle worship. It simply means that when I say I'm worshiping God, what do I mean? Is it simply the songs I sing and that's part of corporate worship or individual worship? When I wake up in the morning, I begin to sing, and many times a special song that I like or appeals to me really connects me with God in the way that I like to feel connected, which is just emotional because he hears me anyhow, whether I feel anything or not, you know. But the singing and the dancing and all of those things are absolutely important in terms of our worship or hallelujahs or thank you, Jesus, and whatever we say, that's important. But more important than that is what we call lifestyle worship. When I come out from what we call a worship session, how do I flesh out that in my everyday life is really what we're dealing with this evening. Right? So how do I treat people? That's absolutely important. Am I kind-hearted, forgiving, etc., etc.? How do I perform my duties at home and at work? How responsible am I? As, for example, I'm a parent. My children are grown now, but I'm a parent. How responsible am I as a parent? That's worship. I'm married. This year, Apostle Vivian and I, in a couple months, going to be celebrating our 46th anniversary, 47th, I think. Anniversary, imagine I'm thinking, you know. And how I treat with him is worship, because my actions must please God. My words must please God. My prayer, my adoration, my personal study of the Bible also will talk about worship, but more than that, my lifestyle. How obedient am I to God? How closely do I live by his word? I'm going to read this, and I need to walk in the instructions and the precepts that are written here. And even if I can't sing, even if I can't dance, even if I cannot play an instrument, but I live to please God. I live as far as I can, because nobody is perfect. But you live as far as you are able to, according to his word. That's worship. And that's what we are trying to deal with when we talk about worship in this sense. Worship, as we indicated, is for God alone. I know we worship other people, and sometimes we worship images and all of that. But when you're talking about the Bible, God is a jealous God, and he wants worship only to himself. We are not to worship anything else. We are not to worship anything God has made. We are not to worship anything that we have made, a man would have made. If you made something, you are the creator of that object. How could you, as the creator of the object, worship the object you created? Who has more power, the creator or the created thing? Right? This is just, to my mind, it seems logical to think like that. Some people think differently, and, you know, whatever, however you choose to think, you know, but I'm just bringing it to you. And so God alone must be worshipped. Some people worship themselves. They make themselves their own gods. And we have to be very careful. And all of that, including self-worship, God considers idolatry. And God has a major problem. Idolatry is big. When we talk about God and what God hates, and God becomes very serious and angry at idolatry. Now, big along with idolatry is unbelief. And I know that's one of these struggles. We don't quite understand how upset God is when we don't believe him. We don't trust him. We don't trust his word. But that's for another time. So worship is for God and God alone. And remember, what we are emphasizing here is not sanctuary worship or worship that you do inside the church within the walls, but lifestyle worship or everyday walking and talking and living. That's the worship that we're paying attention to. Let's look at John chapter 4, verse 23 and 24, and see if we could glean a little bit concerning that. Now, there is so much that you can learn, but I could only give you snippets here. Jesus meets a woman at the well, and we say the woman at the well. Well, the woman at the well meets him. If you look at John chapter 4, verse 3, he, talking about Jesus, left Judea and departed again into Galilee, and he must needs go through Samaria. Then cometh he to a city of Samaria, which is called Sychar, near to the parcel of ground that Jacob gave to his son Joseph. Now Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, therefore, being wearied with his journey, sat thus on the well, and it was about the sixth hour. Then cometh a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said unto her, Give me to drink. For his disciples were gone away unto the city to buy meat. Then said the woman of Samaria unto him, How is it, a thou being a Jew, ask a drink of me, which am a woman of Samaria? For the Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans. Jesus answered and said unto her, If thou knewest the gift of God, and who it is that saith unto thee, Give me to drink, thou wouldest have asked of him, and he would have given thee living water. The woman said unto him, Sir, thou hast nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. From whence then hast thou that living water? Art thou greater than our father Jacob, which gave us the well, and drank thereof himself and his children and his cattle? Jesus answered and said unto her, Whosoever drinketh of this water shall thirst again. But whosoever drinketh of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst. But the water that I shall give him shall be in him a well of water springing up into eternal life. And the conversation kept going to and fro. Jesus asked her some questions and so on and so forth. And then he started off talking about her life, asked about her husbands, and so you need to read it for yourself, John chapter 4. Then it shifted. She shifted the conversation to religion in verse 19. She said, The woman said unto him, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet, when he started to speak to her. Because he asked her about her husband, and he said, Go and call your husband. And she said, Well, I have none. I don't have a husband. And he said, Well, you're right. You had five husbands, and the person you have now, the one you have, is not yours. And then she said, Sir, I perceive that thou art a prophet. Our fathers worshipped in this mountain, and he say that in Jerusalem is a place where men ought to worship. So she started shifting into religion, talking about the place of worship. Because remember, we talked about sanctuary worship and lifestyle worship. And she was talking about sanctuary worship. Verse 21 of John chapter 4, so Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor yet in Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh and now is, when the true worshippers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. Verse 24, he says, God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So, Jesus dealt with a few things with this woman. She brought up a few things, and he said, well, she talked about the place. And he said, no, not really the place, but in spirit. That, in other words, worship has to be a thing of the heart. Worship is not necessarily external. Of course, we do external things. We sing and so on, you know, when we do sanctuary worship, or even, you know, at home, and dance and whatever the other thing that you do. Giving is worship. Whether we give in church, or we give alms, or we doing good deeds could be considered worship. But Jesus says that God judges the quality of our worship, the purity of our worship from the heart. So somebody looking at me from outside can't really judge how effective my worship is. Even I might be very generous. I might be a giving person, but my motives may be wrong. And you looking at me from the outside may applaud me and say, wow, isn't she wonderful? She's always giving, and so on. And then God looks at me and says, she gives with a condescending heart, condescending manner. When she gives to those who are needy, she looks down at them. And he's not as impressed with me as the person on the outside is. So worship is a thing of the heart. Remember, we said that worship is exclusive to God and God alone. And I want to read something I have here. True worship of God is internal, but may be expressed externally. It is a matter of the heart and the spirit, and it must be rooted in the knowledge of and obedience to the word of God. I cannot be a true worshiper if I don't know what the Bible says. Because here is this woman, Samaritan, presenting to Jesus, worshiping a place. Because she thinks, if I go to that place and whatever I do within those walls, I'm worshiping. And Jesus says, no. God is a spirit. And they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. So that helps us along when we feel we go to a worship service in church. So I leave my home and I go. I'm very diligent. I don't miss services. And I go there and I think I've worshipped. And Jesus is saying, no, that's a minuscule part of what heaven will consider worship. Does God receive what we do? Yes, absolutely. If we do it from the heart. And as I said, God alone could judge your heart and my heart. But when we walk out of the doors of the church, that's when we can impress God by what we do. Do I live out what I hear within the walls of the church? Do I flesh out what I hear or what I read in the scripture? If I don't know the Bible, how do I know I'm pleasing God? If I don't know the Bible, if I don't know what God says to do and how he says to do it, how will I know I'm pleasing him? You know, I need to know. And so scripture and the knowledge of the scripture, the knowledge of the Bible is absolutely important in terms if my worship is to be effective. So truthfully, true worship does not confine itself to what we do in church, but how much of what we do and hear in church becomes an integral part of our everyday living. And I want to read two scriptures that are similar. We're going to look at Isaiah 29 from verse 13 to 19, and then it was repeated in Matthew 5, verse 8. So let's go to Isaiah 29. We're starting from verse 13. It says, wherefore the Lord said, for as much as this people draw near me with their mouth and with their lips do honor me, but have removed their heart far from me, and their fear toward me is taught by the precept of men. Therefore, behold, I will proceed to do a marvelous work among the people, even a marvelous work and a wonder. For the wisdom of the wise men shall perish, and the understanding of the prudent men shall be hid. Woe unto them that seek deep to hide their counsel from the Lord, and their words are in the dark. And they say, who seeth us, and who knoweth us? Surely your turning of things upside down shall be esteemed as the potter's clay. For shall the work say of him that made it, he made me not? Or shall the thing framed say of him that framed it, he had no understanding? And so God was saying, in essence, these people are going through certain rituals, but I'm not impressed with their rituals because their heart is not in it. So let's look at Matthew 15:8, it is, and see what Matthew 15:8 says. Verse 7, and Jesus is quoting Isaiah from verse 7 and 8, it says, ye hypocrites, well did Isaiah prophesy of you, saying, this people draweth nigh unto me with their mouth, and honoreth me with their lips, but their heart is far from me. Verse 9 says, but in vain they do worship me, teaching for doctrine the commandments of men. And Jesus used the word worship. In other words, these people go about under the guise that they worship in God, and they're convinced that they are. But when you check, their practice is really doctrines and commandments of men. That's why it's absolutely important, if I'm going to be a worshiper that encounters God, impacts God, reaches God, I must know the word of God. What am I doing? The practices when I go through what I call worship or the rituals of worship, does that have anything to do with the Bible? Is that what the Bible says? Is that what Jesus said? When we look at the book of Acts, and I like to feel that the book of Acts is the prototype for the modern day Church of Jesus Christ. When Jesus raised up his disciples, he empowered them and he left them with the book of Acts, and they were able to go through the motions based on what he taught them. We now must follow what they do. And it must never be said about us that we worship God with our mouths. We do go through all kinds of rituals, but our hearts are not in it.
All I have within
want you to forget what Jesus said. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me.